call today oral culture. And so the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he was raised as the last messenger carrying a divine message from the creator of the heavens and the earth to the people, or to a group of people who did not have a large accumulated amount of knowledge. There were other empires who had a background in China, in Persia, in Egypt, in Rome. There were previous books that were written. But in the Arabian Peninsula, the Arabs at that time did not cherish the writing of books. They cherished their language. They had mastered the Arabic language, which is probably the most powerful of the Semitic linguistic groupings. They had mastered their language, and they took pride in the ability to understand it and to transmit information through this linguistic means. Many people, when they translate the word ummi, because in Arabic they describe the Prophet ﷺ as ummi, they translate that as illiterate. But when you say illiterate in the Western world, it also tends to mean ignorant. But the proper translation is unlettered, because the people at that time were not writing down information. Only 20 people or so could actually write the Arabic language in Mecca at the time. And so he was unlettered, but he was a person of great respect, honored by his society, and an educated, noble person. We might use that terminology today. And Arabia itself did not have vast libraries. They did not have access to the information which was transmitted in other great societies. And Arabic, to a certain extent, could be brought down, or the transmission of Arabic literature, into two main flows. One was poetry, and the other was prose. And so the Arabs read their poetry in a rhythmic fashion, and they understood their language to the point where the meters, or the rhythm within the chapters or the verses that they were reading were well known to them, and they could tell you what type of poetry it was. They also had prose, and prose, as we know, is the telling of the story. But when the Quran was revealed, and this is the book of scripture of the Muslims, the last testament, which came as a finality from the Torah and the Psalms, the Zabor, the Injil, or the Gospels given to Jesus, the Quran came as the last testament, and it is called Muhaymanan Alayh. It is the protector of the other books. When the Quran was revealed through the angel Gabriel, Jibril alayhi salam, to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, when it was revealed over a period of 23 years, those who could speak Arabic realized that this was a miracle. And so the concept that really makes more sense in our discussion is i'jaz, and that means a miracle. What is the miracle in this revelation in relationship to knowledge? The greatest miracle of the Quran is linguistic. That is because the Quran is not poetry, and the Arabs knew that. It is not prose in a normal sense, but it is rhymed prose. So you would have the story, for instance, of Joseph, Yusuf alayhi salam, and the story that he had, and how he was put by his brothers into a well, and he ended in Egypt. And it's a long story, and that whole story is told in a number of pages in perfect rhythm. Every sentence is perfectly rhymed. And so when the Arabs heard this, they admitted, even though they didn't want to worship Allah, they admitted, this is i'jaz. We cannot do anything like this. This is beyond us. And so this is the real living miracle in the Quran. It is a linguistic miracle. And those of you who have access to Semitic languages, those who may be able to go into the Arabic language or have a taste of the Arabic language, would realize that this book, this revelation, is beyond human capability. And in the Quran, there is a type of challenge that is given. And it is saying in the second chapter that if you have any doubt about this book, then you should bring together your intellectuals, your scribes, your poets, bring them together and try to produce a chapter such as the one in this Quran, but you will never be able to do as such. And so from that time until now, Arabic-speaking people have tried to reproduce this rhythmic type of speech. They tried to reproduce it, but they could not do it in such a way that it meets the standards of classical Arabic. It tells the story, and it is in complete rhythm. So that really is the first miracle of the Quran, and it is really the greatest in terms of knowledge. It is a long-standing miracle that has not been touched from that time up until now. The Quran, in Surah An-Najm, the chapter of the star, verse 3 to 5, it tells us, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ عَلَّمَهُ شَدِيدُ الْقُوَىٰ. See how that rhymes? So it says, and he does not speak from himself. It is no less than inspiration sent down to him. He was taught by one mighty in power. And so try to picture it in your mind, a person in Arabia, 1400 years ago, who does not have access to other languages, who does not travel to any libraries in Alexandria, Egypt, or to Persia, or to China, who does not travel outside of the Arabian Peninsula, that this person receives over a period of time a book which has so much information in it that we are still benefiting from this knowledge up until today. And it is still amazing people up until today. It is a living miracle that this could have happened to a person who was living in the middle of the desert. In the 41st chapter of the Quran, it speaks about the creation of the heavens and the earth. And it speaks, and it tells us, ثُمَّ اسْتَوَىٰ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فَهِيَ دُخَانٌ. It said, and then he turned to the heaven when it was smoke. And so it is within the context of a discussion of the creation of the heavens and the earth, and it uses the concept of smoke, that in the beginning it is smoke. Then in Surah Al-Anbiya, the chapter of the Prophet, verse 30, it tells us, أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ كَانَتَ رَتْقًا فَفَتَقْنَاهُمَا وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ أَفَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. As Aqari has so beautifully read in the beginning, have not those who disbelieve known that the heavens and the earth were one connected entity? Then we separated them, and we made every living thing from water. Will they not then believe? Now this verse is saying that the heavens and the earth were one entity, first starting with smoke, and then it is one entity, and then it was broken apart into different sections. This information was taken to the University of Mainz in Germany, and Dr. Alfred Kroner, one of the leading geophysicists in the world, looked at this information and he was in shock, because this is the essence of what is known today as the Big Bang Theory. This is the cutting edge of science. How could a person in the Arabian Peninsula have access to this knowledge when it is only recently that the scientists studying the heavens came to this conclusion that in the beginning there was smoke and this came together, it congealed and formed an entity, and then the entity was broken apart into a number of sections. This is the beginning of creation. This is what they believe. But the Quran, 1400 years ago, to a man living in the middle of the desert who has no access to science and knowledge and equipment, telescopes, no access to this. But yet, his book, or what is coming through him, is describing the creation.